The views expressed on the following broadcasts do not necessarily reflect those of KHLT, Take 12 Radio, or our affiliates. The opinions on this show should not be considered as medical, psychological, or professional advice and are those of the host, co-host, and guest. Take 12 Radio and KHLT Recovery Broadcasting are not affiliated with any particular 12-step fellowship. I want a new drug. When the moon made me sick. Now, here are your co-hosts, Marv R., Bruce H., and the Monty Man.
One that makes me feel like I feel when I'm with you.
Ow!
When I'm alone with you.
Yes, indeedy. Do you want a new drug? You want a new drug, Bruce?
Do I want a new drug?
Do you want a new drug? One that won't make you sick, won't make your eyes too red, or make your brain feel like it's 3 feet thick?
That question scares me.
Well, we're going to be talking about medication. Two topics today. Medication in recovery, and recovery, and unhealthy dependence on other people. And we're going to talk about the medication and recovery thing first. This has been a bone of contention for a lot of people in different recovery fellowships, particularly Narcotics Anonymous. If you bring this topic up in an NA meeting, you get some right fighters that get really angry and say things like, you have no business being on any medication, including Advil, and if you are, you're not clean. I mean, I've heard some pretty heated discussions about that in the fellowship of NA. Not as much in AA, but certainly in NA. And I think one of the reasons is because the focus in NA, even though it is all-inclusive in respect to any mood, mind-altering chemical, the narcotic thing is people are very passionate about that. And so if you say the word drugs at all, they just go, no, you know. And so I think one of the reasons that we have a problem with this topic is because many times we're uninformed.
Sounds like the smoker that quit and now is an advocate for secondhand smoke.
Right. Right. So I thought we would kind of crack this open a little bit. There's... I just tell you something that I learned about this, I'm going to read this short paragraph to you guys and some warning signs. But I know that in many cases, if I'm being treated medically and I don't take my medication, I may go out and medicate. You know what I'm saying? Because if I'm not following the doctor's orders. The problem today is we know statistically-wise that more doctors are prescribing inappropriate pain medication to people than there are drug dealers on the street. So there's that issue, you know. So I think a lot of it falls on the responsibility of us. We have to make sure that our doctors are informed. We have to make sure that they know who we are, what struggles we have. We need to be very transparent with them. We pay doctors thousands of dollars a year, and then we lie to them. Are you eating right? Oh, yeah, I am. Are you smoking? No, I don't smoke anymore. And as soon as you go out to your car to leave to go home, you're lighting one up. You know what I mean? We do the craziest things. But we need to make sure that our general practitioners are informed about us. And then we need to make sure that our general practitioners are educated about this stuff. And quite frankly, in the circles where I've talked to medical professionals, we're talking sometimes not even 3 hours of drug and alcohol education. Addiction education in their whole entire medical school. That is pathetic. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of these doctors, you better be careful. You know, I did have a doctor who was a drug dealer. I mean, not intentionally. I mean, he would write a script. I mean, if I told him I had a paper cut, he would give me Oxycontin. You know what I'm saying? I mean, a guy was just like, this is the easiest way out. I'll just write him a script. And I didn't know any better. But neither did he. So they're out there. They go all the way from that, all the way to the other extreme, where, you know, they may not even make an appointment to see you if they think you're just whining. You know, I mean, they can go so far the other way, too. So here's an article by, and then I'll let you guys chime in on this, Dr. Stephen Granstead from Recovery Today Online. He says, many people in chronic pain are afraid to take their opiate pain medication because they have heard horror stories of people getting hooked on pain pills. This leads to a decision to under-medicate, and then they end up suffering as a result. On the other hand, not taking effective precautions could lead to developing an addictive disorder. If you happen to be in recovery for alcoholism or other drug addiction, the problem is even worse. If you under-medicate it, you could trigger a relapse. Of course, the other side of the coin is over-medication, which could lead to rapid tolerance building and finally reactivation of an existing addictive disorder that was in remission, i.e., the phenomenon of craving. In the following exercise, you will see a list of red flags or indicators that someone is using their pain medication in a manner that could eventually lead to problems or even addiction. Both you, your support network, and your treatment providers need to be familiar with these red flags and to seek professional help from a person trained in addiction who also has experience, understanding, or training in pain management if problems surface. By doing this, you will be able to work with your healthcare providers to make better decisions about using potentially problematic pain medications. Now, the following things to many listeners are going to be a no-brainer, but there are people listening that have never even considered this. Number one, after adjusting to the medication, you would score yourself from 0 to 10 on this. Number one, after adjusting to medication, do you still experience a sense of euphoria? If according to the directions you are supposed to be, have adjusted at this point, whether it's a week or 3 weeks or whatever it is, depending on the medication, are you still experiencing euphoria from the medication? Number two, are you starting to have preoccupation with your pain medication? Is it all you think about? Bruce refers to this as watching the clock, right?
Yep.
Yep. Number three, you start having urges or cravings about your pain medication. Four, there is an abnormal increase in tolerance, requiring frequent increases in doses without doctor's advice. Five, there is a decrease in your non-problematic pain medication activities. In other words, you stop taking your Advil. You stop taking your Tylenol. You're depending on this other stuff. Are you starting to use non-prescribed substances, including alcohol and or other drugs, i.e. marijuana, over-the-counter allergy medicine, methamphetamine, etc.? Seven, are you unable to take your pain medication as prescribed? Eight, are you experiencing problems with thinking, feelings, and or behaviors? Talk about a no-brainer on that one. I have problems with that, just sober.
That's just what I was thinking.
Number nine, your quality of life and relationships are being negatively impacted by your use of your pain medication. 10, you continue problematic use of medication despite experiencing negative consequences. 11, you use medications in physically dangerous situations, i.e. driving a car, operating power tools, providing child care to young children. And number 12, you experience withdrawal symptoms if you go too long between doses or stop your medication abruptly. Sounds like some no-brainers, but are they? Some people don't even consider this. There are people that are addicts, alcoholics, alcoholics, and they've never, ever, ever touched any kind of opiate-based pain medication in their life. Maybe they were a pothead and they like to drink too much. And, you know, maybe they were even a meth user. But opiates, you know, or the medications today, they never dealt with. They weren't part of their bag of tricks. And something happens and they're re- required to take it. So, you know, as some post-surgical event happens and they need to take pain medication, and they experience something they had no idea. That was my experience. What happened? So these red flags are very important. Bruce, did you want to comment on this?
Yeah, I fall in the category of the kind of person that doesn't take his medication. As the doctor says, I take less.
You under-medicate.
Yeah, I under-medicate, and I so I suffer with pain, you know. And I think that I'm doing it on some sort of level where I can control that. So I'm not worried about going out, because the key thing for me is that when I do take the medication, I'm acutely aware as if there's something going on if I want to take more of it. You know, if I'm watching the clock, like I say.
Right.
You know, if that craving gets kicked off, if, well, I took one pill, that I'd really feel good if I took three pills.
So do you think that because you under-medicate, you take less than what the doctor prescribes, that helps you to stay clear mind and you don't go into those
because
areas?
I don't have an accountability thing put together right now, and my sponsor is ill and trying to work mm-hmm. at the same time. I'm scared to death.
To take the full dose, for instance.
I'm scared to death.
Yeah.
Because I know that I'm sensitive to this stuff. There's something that happens to me. I'm taking this stuff in the hospital, and the nurse brings me the dose, and I tell her, oh, I'm only supposed to take a half, you know, not a full dose. And she took it back, and immediately, you know what I told myself? What, am I crazy? Why did I do that? And yeah, now yeah. I'm watching the clock.
Right.
See, and that's where I got that clock thing from. I'm staring at it, and I'm telling myself, if she brings a full dose this time, I'm going to take it, because I'm going to leave the hospital, and that won't happen anymore. So I'll be able to control it. That's a load of crap.
Mm.
See, and so when I got out, of course, I still wanted some more. And my sponsor walked with me and stayed close to me and held me accountable, you see, until I got through that period one right. more time.
Right.
And didn't abuse it, because I think I would have abused the Oxycontin that they give me to take, go home with. Now, I had a very serious operation, a heart operation.
Yeah.
But that's what happened to me. And so today, because of my back and my knee, and I can't have any operations because, you know, I had that heart failure.
You may not come out of it at all. Yeah.
So but I'm scared to death to take this stuff because I don't have a solid foundation, number one. And number two, what happens if if my mind, you know.
If the allergy takes off?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd like to say it's purely a thing of being dependent upon God, that God could get me through it, and I think he could,
mm-hmm.
you know. But I also know he hasn't removed that. He removed
the allergy?
He removed the obsession I don't want to use, and I don't think about it.
And that's why you're able to take only half, because the obsession's not there.
Right.
Right.
But he is, I don't know that he's removed the other part, because it shows up the minute I start putting this stuff in my body,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
So it frightens me to death. And I will have to at some point, because of the condition I'm in, build that structure back up where I'll have accountability, where I have someone that I can depend on that'll come into my life and enter into it with me and walk with me and make sure that I'm okay. I do not trust the pain doctors.
Right.
I don't.
Right.
Believe me, I don't want to get into it. It's a whole new program, but when we start that, but I don't trust them. I don't trust doctors, period.
Mm.
When it comes to pain management, we have to be aware of this thing.
So it really, a lot of that responsibility is going to lie on us.
My doctors know, and I, you know, And but that's it. But I'm saying we are accountable for our actions.
Yeah.
You know, when that happens, we better. If we've learned anything in Alcoholics Anonymous, it's, you know, to have a structure.
Right.
You know.
Right. Marv, how about you? Have you struggled with this at all, as far as having to take medication in your sobriety and having to manage it well? And
I take medications, not pain medication, but and I don't like it. I hate to have to depend on medication. I'm one of them type people. I just,
is it because of the way it makes you feel, or you just don't like having?
I just don't like the idea of it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But I do want to make a couple other comments. And I'm ignorant in this subject. So what I'm about to say are things that I think about.
Uh-huh.
Number one, not all doctors, but a lot of doctors, in my opinion, do not have integrity.
Mm.
Number two, there's too many people for the amount of doctors that we have.
Right.
And the almighty dollar has a lot to do with the power behind pharmaceutical doctors. And that's just the way I see it.
I agree.
As you guys know, I haven't talked about this on the air, but my wife died from OxyContin. And I am not in a position to judge either the doctor or her, because I'm not sure exactly what happened.
Mm-hmm.
But I also have another friend who suffers greatly because he's taken too much OxyContin and it's affected his major organs. Mm-hmm. And he's suffering from it. So, I have these ideas about it, but yet I'm not the one to sit in judgment on it. I know I'm angry about it.
And you actually join a lot of people, treatment providers, sober living professionals, a lot of people in the industry, the treatment industry, that are really, and I'm talking about the treatment industry that's holistic, people that are working on not just teaching people how to get sober, but teaching them how to stay sober, nutrition, mindfulness, their spiritual walk, that kind of thing. These kind of people are very angry and very frustrated with what you're talking about. I see this presented at some of the conventions I go to. They're ticked because they feel like they're fighting this losing battle within the industry they're in.
You know, they're very frustrated. There's something that happens to us when, you know, drugs are my mainstay in this whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
And when we start taking these things, whether it's for a medical reason or not, something happens to our brain and we start thinking funny. And what goes through it isn't just the phenomenon of craving, you know, but we start to lie and we start to say, do other things, and we start to manipulate. And we, you know, and the people around us are baffled.
Our brain chemistry.
Yeah, they don't know why we're acting this way. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
And if we don't have a program set and locked in place and God on our side, that'll overcome us, you know. And then we have tragedies like what's happened to Marv.
Right.
You know.
Right.
But we're just, the people around us are just left baffled, you know. And that's the same thing with alcohol as it is with drugs, I will say. You know.
Sure.
A person gets to drinking and they can't put it down and they have to keep having it, whether it's that phenomenon of craving, or it's just the habit itself. You know, the body needs it. I'm telling you that something happens and they lose their ability to communicate with other people on a proper level.
And Marv, you touched on too many people per doctors, without getting into a debate about the Affordable Care Act, that's one of the problems this has presented. Doctors are being overwhelmed by the amount of people coming in, and so their ability to effectively treat them drops. Quality of care drops.
Well, and let me add to that. You know, it's not like, okay, 40 years ago when I would go to a doctor, it would be a one-on-one. There would be no looking at the watch and, well, you need to get out of here. Mm-hmm. It was more personable, more open. You knew the doctor a whole lot better than and he knew you or she knew you, whatever the case mm-hmm. may be. In this day and age, our doctors are operating out of these HMOs I'm not going to throw a name out, but these big corporations these doctors work for. I actually had my doctor tell me a couple of months ago that he only had so much time with me because he had to see so many patients in a day.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what does that tell you?
Yeah.
And the other frustration I've had is through the insurance that I have. Like I said, I'm not going to mention names. They give me a PA instead of a medical doctor.
Right.
And I've, like Bruce, have had some serious medical situations. And believe me, I don't have much faith in the way things are going.
Yeah, neither do I.
So that's just another thing.
See, now I just come at it from a little different angle.
Yeah.
A little different experience.
Well, that's why I love having both of you guys.
But I still have that bad taste in my mouth.
Yeah.
And if we have that going on, and plus the pills being given to us, whose responsibility is it?
Yeah, and if we're not able to be responsible because we're early in recovery, our brain isn't cleared yet or anything, we're going to be in trouble. That's why we need people to make the approach. We need people to come. We don't need to be waiting for people to ask us to be sponsors. We need to make the approach and come alongside these folks because they don't got a clue.
I got young people that are going and this is happening to them and they don't have any clue, like you said.
Mm-hmm.
There's a person that we, all three of us, know that got involved with some medical stuff and had to start taking prescriptions, and after 20-some years of sobriety had to go to a detox center to get off these things.
Right.
And was abusing them.
Yeah.
It just stuck right up on them. They didn't even know.
Yeah.
Wasn't even
yep.
aware.
Yep. Well, I have a saying that I repeat about once every 6 months or even more. Nobody, unless it's life or death, nobody be cutting on me anymore. Not because of the surgery. I'm not afraid of the surgery. But those pain medications,
aftercare.
Absolutely.
There you
I
go.
Am scared to death of that.
Good for you guys. Well put.
And if it's life or death, I get it. But if it's just if my knees go out, my knees go out. I don't want to have anything to do with that crap anymore. I mean, I almost died. You know, I mean, just, I didn't want to go into. All right, so we're going to take go ahead.
Yeah, I don't know about you, but Monty, I almost get physically sick when I have to go to the doctor.
Mm.
It is so stressful to me because of my distrust.
And it should be the other way around. All right, I'm going to go see my doctor and I'm going to feel better.
Yeah, it should
but
be.
It's the other way. Yeah, I hear you. I hear you. All right, so if you've got an opinion about this, please don't hesitate to email us, take12radio@comcast.net. We're going to take a break. Cecil's got some Take 12 trivia, and then we're going to go into our next topic, unhealthy dependence on others, when we come back.
Hey, running around in the meetings, gobbling up gallons of bad coffee, flapping his gums wherever he can bring a smile to a hurting face. It's Slogan Man! We know cute little platitudes and sayings on the wall in 12-step meeting won't keep you sober, but they sure will make you think, consider, and even laugh your way through an otherwise crappy day. Can't wait to get to your home group to hear those slogans over and over and over and over again? No need to. Pick up a copy of the 12-Step Gazette and join the adventures of Slogan Man. Visit www.12stepgazette.com and subscribe today. Slogans and platitudes are no substitute for working the steps, but Slogan Man is very cool.
Men, women, and their families experience tremendous pain and suffering due to the struggles they face from substance abuse and its co-occurring mental health challenges. They need to find a safe place for peace and healing. Therapia Addiction Healing Center was born out of a deep desire to provide that safe and powerful healing environment. Therapia exists to help people recover from addictions by developing and maintaining healthy, meaningful relationships with God, self, and others. To speak with an addiction specialist, call 1-855-652-4325. That's 1-855-652-4325. Or visit our website at www.therapia.net. Therapia Addiction Healing Center. Restoring lives one step at a time.
Wow, I'm so glad we're done with those commercials so we can play Take 12 Trivia.
That's right. It's Bruce Amar's favorite game show, Take 12 Trivia. Brought to you by Freedom Interventions at freedominterventions.com. Matt and the gang. If you're in need of an intervention, Matt can help. All right. Here is your Take 12 Trivia question number one. Oh, by the way, this is absolutely useless trivia, meaningless trivia. Probably won't help you in anything in life.
Well, good. I don't have to answer then.
No, you do have to answer. Otherwise, I'll bop you on the head. Okay, here we go. The name, this name was never recorded as an actual name in history until the book Peter Pan was written. In fact, it was exclusively written for the book. What is the name? And here are your three choices. Peter, Wendy, or Jacob?
I thought it was Tinkerbell.
Wendy.
Mara says, Wendy. I know what you're thinking. Go ahead, Bruce. What do you think? Peter, Wendy, or Jacob?
Peter.
He's not thinking, is he?
No.
Well, Marv is actually correct. It is Wendy. What's Marv get?
Are you still getting heartburn flare-ups?
How was
Time
Marv
for
thinking?
A new routine.
I know what he was thinking. Can I guess what you were thinking?
Okay.
Peter and Jacob are both biblical names.
Right.
So they were before the book Peter Pan was ever written.
Yeah.
See, Bruce, oh, wow. you gotta think.
That's right.
Yeah.
That is just like...
I know, that's
good
lightning speed thinking.
Good thinking. I should have followed Marv, see?
Okay, number two, the word samba, means what? Here are your three choices.
Windy.
It does not mean windy.
Oh.
The word samba either means the dance of the night, rubbing navels together, or does it mean slow dance?
Oh, wow.
Samba.
So what was the first one?
The dance of the night.
I'll take the last one then.
Slow dance?
Yeah.
Marv?
I'm going to say dance of the night.
Well, you both would be incorrect. It actually means rubbing navels together.
Oh.
Yeah.
Knock it off.
Yeah, no, it does. And this is what you get for that. Ready?
You think things through and want to know if something's going to work for you.
So is samba the cause of navel jelly?
Probably. And probably Lent.
Oh,
so next time you can, let's dance a samba. You know what you're supposed to be doing. Oh my goodness. Okay, trivia question number three. More of this type of fake money. more of this type of fake money is made over every other type of fake money. Number one, chocolate coins wrapped in gold or silver paper. Number two, Monopoly money. Or number three, counterfeit bills.
Oh, wow. I'm going to go with the counterfeit bills. I bet it's Monopoly.
What do you think, Marv?
Chocolate's pretty important, too.
Chocolate coins, Monopoly, or counterfeit money?
Say the question again.
More of this type of fake money is made over every other type of fake money. Chocolate coins wrapped in gold and silver paper, Monopoly money, or counterfeit money?
All right. I'm going to take the dive chocolate.
You're going to take the dive chocolate? Well, and Bruce, you said, what did you say?
Counterfeit.
Well, you both would be incorrect. It's Monopoly money.
Yeah, I knew it.
Monopoly money.
I knew that.
It's back by popular demand.
Hey, no, I knew that.
Why didn't you say that?
Well, I'm going for all wrong answers.
No. Okay. Here's your bonus. Your bonus question.
See, I'm close. Windy.
Okay, listen to this. This will blow your mind. If a person places only one drop of this substance on the back of a scorpion, it will instantly go insane and sting itself to death. Here are your choices. Hot sauce, alcohol, or cow urine. Just one drop of this on the back of a scorpion.
Cow urine.
Bruce is going.
Alcohol.
Yeah, or hot sauce.
Or hot sauce.
What do you think, Marv?
Good God. I'm going to go with the hot sauce.
Okay.
Wow. What a question.
I know.
All right, just be different. Cow urine.
Cow urine. Well, you're both incorrect. It's alcohol. One drop of alcohol. Good reason why when you're out on the prairie, you should always have...
Is it rubbing alcohol?
A can of beer. Actually, it didn't specify. It just said alcohol. So let's see what you get for this.
Everyone has an off day.
Yes, everyone has an off day.
Well, I feel like a winner.
Do you? Are you a winner, Bruce?
4 out of 4.
All right. Unhealthy dependence on other people. When we return.
As men and women who have recovered from utterly hopeless states of addiction ourselves, we know all too well what it's like to battle addiction daily. We are Origins Recovery Centers. Here at Origins, we have taken that which we have learned along the way, excised anything unhelpful and unnecessary, infused it with the latest medical research and innovative therapeutic methods, and created what we know to be the absolute gold standard in substance abuse treatment. And Origins provides the most preeminent aftercare and relapse prevention program available in the United States. For a free confidential clinical assessment, call toll-free 888-843-8935. That's 888-843-8935. Origins, delivering real solutions for real families.
Choosing a facility for drug and alcohol rehabilitation treatment is an important decision. It should be a place where you will be comfortable and supported, and one that is staffed, equipped, and programmed for successful outcomes. Introducing Free by the Sea, located on 5 acres of secluded waterfront property along the southwest Washington coast, away from big city distractions. The campus is a renovated resort property, so the grounds are lush and beautiful. Above all, the reason to choose Free by the Sea is the success rate of our counselors and staff in helping clients to transition to a life free from addiction. For more information or to schedule a visit, call 800-272-9199 or visit our website at www.freebythesea.com. Free by the Sea, charting a new course to recovery.
You know, I just got to thinking, isn't it good to know that scorpions, unless you put the alcohol on them, are sober? They're allergic to alcohol. It makes them go crazy, just like people, some people. So if you run into a scorpion, I think it's nice to know that he's sober. Don't you, Marv?
Huh.
Have you ever had that imagination of yours checked?
I'm like Marv. I don't trust those guys to check my imagination.
It's like my grandson playing with the prop on the back of the boat. And I go, what are you doing, son? He goes, using my imagination, Grandpa, using my imagination.
Oh, my goodness. Mm-hmm. All right. So Monday show, this last Monday show, I read this. And so if you tuned into Monday show, just bear with me. We do something as we're born with something as infants. And actually, it doesn't start once we're born. It actually starts in the womb. And that is, we are 100% dependent on mom. And for our nutrition, for our blood flow, for the chemicals that our body creates to create the growth process in the womb, we're dependent. We don't have any control over it. We're dependent. When we're born, we're dependent. We're dependent on mom for coddling, for warmth, for nursing, to be fed, to be protected. I mean, it's a natural dependency. It's supposed to be that way. We get a little older. We're dependent. Maybe we're going to kindergarten. We depend on mom to make our lunch. We depend on dad to give us a ride, or the school bus driver to give us a ride. There's dependency there. It's okay. It's supposed to be there. The problem occurs when we get older and we remain dependent like that on other people, and we don't mature into some form of independence. Then, if we do form some form of independence, we have another problem that happens. Sometimes we become overly independent, and we think we shouldn't be dependent on anything, including God. And what we end up doing is we fall back into unhealthy dependency. And in many cases, many of us, particularly people in recovery, have learned to become unhealthily dependent on other people. When this happens, we are sorely disappointed. Because when we are dependent on others for our self-esteem, for our maturity, for everything in our lives, and we put that on other people, that is a bill they can't fit that bill, because they're dependent, and they don't have the ability to fulfill our expectations. And then when we put even unreasonable expectations on people, what we have is a recipe for building resentments. People do not give them to resentments. Give us resentments. They don't put them in a little box, wrap them up, and hand them to us. We build them ourselves. And much of the time, the main ingredient to that is dependence on other people to fulfill something that they are unable to fulfill. This is something that was a huge part of my downfall, and was a big reason why I medicated for years, through high school, through college even, and later on. I was so dependent on you to approve of me, for me to be okay with me. And even if you were okay with me, it wasn't good enough. You could shower me with money, with your time, with your attention, and it would never be enough. And somewhere inside, I thought, you don't really believe that. You're just doing that. I don't know why you're doing that, but you really truly don't care. And this was a real source of problems for me. I was addicted to your acceptance of me. I was dependent on that. And then something happened to me after I'd been in my 12-step fellowship for some time. And I wasn't doing well is because this carried over into that. And something happened to me. I had a friend of 25 years He was a drinking buddy. He was a using buddy. We did all sorts of inappropriate behavior together. We also had sober time together. We had a relationship with the Lord together. I mean, we just went through all sorts of stuff from A to Z. And I had placed that title of best friend on him without his permission. He didn't want it. And I forced that on him. I mean, by God, you're going to be my best friend and everybody should have a best friend. And you know, that's the way it is. I thought that's the way life was. And after 25 years, I got a Dear Monty letter from this guy. And he said, because of his own, for his own health, for his own recovery, even though we'd both been sober for some time, he had to cut all ties and he didn't want anything to do with me ever, 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 ever again. Now, he's a believer. I was a believer as well. And it crushed me. I mean, it just crushed me. And I was in mourning over this. I didn't know how to maneuver that. And one day I was cruising the internet and I came across this poem. And the good Lord did something in my heart, and it all changed. It blew my mind. And here's the poem. This poem is called A Reason, A Season, and A Lifetime. Have either one of you heard this?
No.
Here it goes. There's three sections, A Reason, A Season, and A Lifetime. The first one, A Reason. When someone is in your life for a reason, it is usually to meet a need you have expressed. They have come to assist you through a difficulty, to provide you with guidance and support, to aid you physically, emotionally, or spiritually. They may seem like a godsend, and they are. They are there for a reason you need them to be. Then, without any wrongdoing on your part, or at an inconvenient time, this person will say or do something to bring the relationship to an end. Sometimes they die. Sometimes they walk away. Sometimes they act up and force you to take a stand. What we must realize is that our need has been met, our desire fulfilled, their work is done. The prayer you sent up has been answered, and now it is time to move on. That's the first one, a reason. The second one, when people come into your life for a season, because your turn has come to share, grow, or learn, they bring you an experience of peace or make you laugh. They may teach you something you have never done. They usually give you an unbelievable amount of joy. Believe it, it's real, but it's only for a season. And the third one, lifetime relationships teach you lifetime lessons. Things you must build upon in order to have a solid emotional foundation. Your job is to accept the lesson, love the person, and put what you have learned to use in all other relationships and areas of your life. It is said that love is blind, but friendship is clairvoyant. So in the reason piece, when something happened and it says without any wrongdoing or your part or at an inconvenient time, in my case, it was at an inconvenient time. There was plenty of wrongdoing on my part. But there was no convenient time for this person to say, I'm done. But when I read this, it was like, I get it. I get it. These things are seasonal, except for lifetime friendships, which are rare. There's a purpose for people in our lives. And sometimes that chapter just changes. And if we are so dependent on other people to fulfill our own self-worth and not dependent on the only one that can do that, we're setting ourselves up for, if not a relapse, for possible suicide. And people take their lives over this stuff all the time. So I wanted to shoot that out there. To the listeners, because I think this is so vital to understand that there is only one that will never leave you or forsake you. There is only one that will meet your needs the way your needs need to be met. And you may think God isn't fulfilling your expectations because he knows better than you do. So you may think, well, he's not there. Or whatever. Let me tell you, he is. He's not non-present. People are people. And when this light switch changed for me, it made all the difference in the world. I went from being people-dependent to being God-dependent. Anything other, in my opinion, other than God-dependency is an unhealthy dependence.
There's a thing about Alcoholics Anonymous that is just wonderful, and it simply amazed me. And I'm going to try to tie this together and not take all the time here. When we do a four-step and we write the column, fourth column, we write down where we were selfish, self-seeking, dishonest, and frightened.
Right.
Okay, but the relationship with these people. What I seen because of this self-seeking, okay, that's what I would do to get what I want. And that little dance I would do and how I would try to people please and things like that because it was so important to me. Mm. And the selfish part is what I would do to keep what I have.
Mm.
You see? Mm-hmm. And how I reacted behind that. When I was honest and open about those things and took a good look at that, I didn't like what I seen.
Mm.
I seen who I was and the selfishness of who I was and how I had become dependent upon my wife and my mother and things that you're talking about. This was my inventory I took, and it exposed to me my need for God. Now, here's the thing you'll never know if you don't do it. I don't think you'll ever know. You can talk about it all day long. But the minute that I gave my life to Him and become God-dependent, for the first time in my life, I became independent.
Ooh, that's a mouthful. What a powerful statement.
Yeah.
So your independence grew out of your dependence upon God.
Yeah. Say, I was in bondage to self. God relieved that, and today I'm in service to Him. And some people say slave.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and the word that...
Or bondservant. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And... but I felt from that relationship, it's the first time I've had any kind of form of independence and to have the kind of relationships that I've craved my whole life because my dependence is in Him and from that flows my relationship with others because of the wonderment of who He is and what He's done. But you have to know both aspects, guys. You have to know the problem and you have to know the solution. If you have a problem and there's no solution to it, just telling your story and just, you know, knowing it isn't going to do you one bit of good.
Yeah.
And if you have the solution and nothing to apply it to, it's just like it's out there.
Yeah.
And that's where I think most people that are religious or things have got that, but they don't see their need for this Savior.
So. Yeah, so that's why we say sometimes... Within the secular recovery community, we understand the problem but not the solution. And within the faith community, we understand the solution but not the problem.
Exactly.
And we got to get on the same page.
Exactly. Yeah. So that's my little take on that.
Yeah.
So.
Thanks, Bruce.
Yeah.
Marv?
What?
Hello. I love it when he does that.
I love
what?
It.
Yeah. Well, that's an honest response.
Sure
What
is.
Do you want, Mommy? Ever fallen into being dependent on other people and been sorely disappointed?
All the time.
All the time, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And what Bruce just got through talking about, I struggle. I'm still struggling today to try to find that place where my dependence is entirely upon Christ. Mm-hmm. And... it's not very comfortable when you're struggling.
Right.
One of the things I thought about while you guys were talking is, you know, if the person is dependent and he has a relationship, let's say, albeit temporary, a successful relationship with somebody or in some... That other somebody is just as dependent as the person who's trying to initiate the relationship.
Right on.
one of the things that I've kept foremost in my mind through a long time in AA meetings is, and maybe I'm wrong, I don't know, but when I walk in a room, I immediately think, okay, God is in this room, and he is going to work through these people to teach me something. I am not to depend on the people. I'm to depend on God to do that. So that little area there, I feel like I've pretty well been on the money. I've seen so many crazy things in the meetings and years ago that I figured out right away it's not a good idea for me to depend. You know, I can learn from them, which mm-hmm. is very important.
Mm-hmm.
But through the struggles I've had the last 2 or 3 years, I've discovered that that I've got that problem. So what I'm working on now, or maybe I should say what God's working on now, is to teach me to depend on him.
Yeah.
And this is not fun, people.
No.
It is not fun. I'm convinced in the end he's going to win. So mm-hmm. that keeps me going.
Yeah, but don't you think that I agree with you, and I think it's that process of learning to grow. But we live in this secular world.
A broken world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what I'm convinced of, the thing that it's just given me amazement is why I made the statement I did, is that you and me and Monty, you and me, and Marv and me, we couldn't have the relationship that we have if it wasn't for Christ.
True.
See,
true enough.
It's a whole different ball game. Because it's called the fellowship of the Spirit,
mm-hmm.
you know. And I don't think people want to miss that one, because my attitude is different than it used to be. I'm not looking to see what I can get from Marv. I'm looking to see what I can add to our relationship. The same thing with you. Now, see, that's upside down and backwards from what I used to be. It was used to be this selfish, self-seeking, dishonest, frightened individual.
Mm-hmm.
Today it's this, what can I add? What can I do?
See, right.
That's different, brother.
Right.
And that's called the fellowship of the Spirit.
You bet. You bet.
And we had to learn to walk by that Spirit, to live by it, and out of the blessings, you know. That he's already given us.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know. We just go on and on with this thing. But I agree with Marv. It's a struggle because we live and operate in this secular world. And there's so much that wants to take my focus off of that.
Oh, yeah. Gosh, isn't there? Okay. We're bombarded by it. We talked about that last night.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're bombarded by worldly clamors. It's like dodging bullets constantly,
mm-hmm.
you know. And that's why we need the fellowship of the Spirit. That's why we need each other that are on the same page. That's why we need to lift each other up and continue to encourage each other. And not in an unhealthy, dependent way.
Yeah, it could be downright painful here.
Yeah, absolutely.
And what we're doing in AA, I think that what I'm doing anyway, is I'm trying to teach people to be drop this sponsor thing and all that other kind of stuff. And don't become sponsor dependent and step dependent, but become God dependent.
Yeah.
See, now I use.
Now you're not saying don't have a sponsor.
No,
you're saying
I'm a sponsor.
Stop depending on your sponsor to fulfill what only God can.
And why are the steps there?
Yeah.
And when you get the knowledge, is it going to save you? Or is it exposing your need for? It's like the law was put there. Why?
For us. We weren't made for that, for the law. The law was made for us.
See?
Yeah.
So there's a huge difference in the steps of the same way.
So there's two statements that I want people to chew on this week. And I mentioned this on Monday's show, and I'm gonna say it again. The first one is, you and I are powerless over other people's choices. We can hinder their choices. We can contribute to them. We can encourage them. We can participate in some of the stuff that happens on their way to making a choice. We can do all of that stuff. But bottom line, when people make a decision, it's their choice. It's theirs. You don't own it. They own it. And once I learned I was powerless over it, like in the case of my friend saying later, that was his choice. I couldn't force him back into our friendship. It wouldn't have been healthy anyway because it was already toxic. But I'm powerless over other people's choices. Their final decision is theirs. And once I understand that, my attempt to control them becomes less and less. The second thing I want people to get is that I don't know that we're called to trust people. I think we're called to trust God and love people. You may not agree with that, but I'm learning that if I will trust him and love you, and I think that's what Marv, you were saying. You're trusting God to work through those people in the fellowship. You're not trusting them.
Right.
Marcia is trusting God to work through me as her husband. She's not trusting me. And I think if we will understand that our call is to trust him and love others, then it's easier for us to understand that we're powerless over other people's choices. And we will do better. So that's my closing thoughts for this week. And while you're at it, try not to over-medicate. I'll bring both topics together. If you're on medication and you're struggling, you know, you can email us here at Take12Radio@comcast.net. We'll pray for you. That's a hard struggle. If you're overly dependent on other people to be okay with you, send me an email. I'd love to pray for you. That's hard. It's hard to break away from these things. You know, it's hard to detox from medications that have got you, just as it is hard to detox from being dependent on people and not on God, because we've been doing it for so long. Thank you guys for today.
Can I say one more thing?
Yes, you may.
Before we leave, there is a book out there that I think is very powerful. It's called The Search for Significance. And I can't remember the author's name right off the top of my head, but if you think you want to deal with this problem of codependence and dependence on other people, that book is excellent. Excellent. So I would highly recommend it.
I like what Marv says. He says, if you think you're running something, order your neighbor's dog around.
Yeah, if you're a person of great influence.
Oh, my goodness. All right, The Search for Significance, Seeing Your True Worth Through God's Eyes, is by Robert McGee.
Yes.
And I'll put a link on that up on the website on Wednesday's page. The Amazon link for that, if you'd like to get that. You can get that. I'm looking here. You can also get that in Audible format as well. Thanks. Thanks, Marv.
Yep.
Very good. Very, very good. All right, my friends, until next time, this is the Monty Man along with Marv and Bruce, and we're wishing God's perfect serenity for you.
This has been a broadcast of Take 12 Recovery Radio and KHLT Recovery Broadcasting.
She's a super cat, she's super kitty, meow.